Terima kasih saudara-saudari pengurusi majlis. Selamat pagi dan salam sejahtera saya ucapkan kepada Dr. Norida binti Muhammad, Timbalan Dekan Hal Ehwal Pelajar dan Alumni, pengurusi majlis pagi ini, Encik Sufian dan Encik Salman Salim dan juga Puan Emilda. Terlebih dahulu, saya ingin mengucapkan ribuan terima kasih kepada pihak penganjur kerana sudi menjemput saya untuk memberi talk, engineering talk to be a professional engineer and any other similar topics that I can cover. Sebab, I think the last time I was in this hall, sorry, I'll be missing English and Malay.
Chinese one way.
And I got to know that there are a few international students here as well, right? If you don't mind, can I know who are the international students so I can know the numbers? Can you just raise up your hand, please? Okay, thanks. Thank you. So I'll just continue in English. If you have problem or anything later after the talk, maybe you can come and see me personally. I can explain to you more. Okay. First of all, as I said, it has been like nearly 11 years I have left this wonderful university, my alma mater. I think the last time I was in this hall, I was doing my final year paper, which I walked out early before the time finished. So it brings me all the memories, very sweet, and yeah, we do have some bad memories as well. But that's how we gain experience, you see. Okay, so today I'm here to guide all students here who will be the next engineers, so-called, and maybe few of them or most of you all will become the professional engineers in your field. Okay, and before I start my talk, just want to highlight something. When I was in second or third year in Ito, there was a visiting professor from UTM, because at the time we have our administration of Ito was under UTM, so the lecturer came to the class, he taught us mathematics and calculus, and he mentioned something which still sticks in my head. He said, okay, so you guys all now, you are all in third year, right? Okay. Third year, so you nak jadi jurutera or jurutera? You know? So you say jurutera, yeah, so you mean you are going to be a super duper engineer. So I might as well call you a jurutera. Why? Because for your information, civil engineering is one of the sectors among other engineering sectors where we have very well diversified branches compared to other engineering field like mechanical or electrical. So, without further ado, I'll start my presentation. So, as you know, my name is Sridharan Raman, so you can address me Sri. So, so currently I'm attached with Department of Irrigation Drainage Malaysia, and just for your information, why I put all these wonderful logos, because these are the four organizations which have made me to stand here today and give the talk to you. And please, I'd like to mention this, I'm not representing any of these organizations for today's talk. So I'm coming under alumni and on my personal capacity. So kalau ada tersilap kata ke anything, so don't think I'm representing from there, then you won't complain there lah. Because now the era of IT, I takut can be a what, overnight YouTube celebrity. I hope there's no videos taking me. Okay. So the first thing first, as I said, civil engineering is a very well diversified sector. So you can see here, basically, civil engineering revolves around
yeah.
Water resources, construction, environment, geotechnical, material, structure, transportation, urban planning. Transportation includes of roadworks and so on. So, tapi if you see in detail, each sector, when you enter, let's say you take water resources, you will deal with construction, environment, geotechnical, material, structure, transportation, and urban planning. So, the big thing will be water resources, but it's all interrelated. And each sector needs an engineer, especially civil engineer, to be in these sectors. So, you see, our responsibility is very big. So, you see, you must be well versed with construction, environment, geotech, material, structure, transportation, urban planning. But don't worry, we are not Superman. Even though we are true terror, but we are not Superman or Superwoman. That's why we need a teamwork where we will have people in different specialization in the team to make sure we get success. Okay. So next, this is something I came across. And a civil engineer, if you like, safe drinking water, clean environment, efficient transportation, and there's so many other things as well. But a lot of people in public, they tak perasan kan, what is the contribution of civil engineer? They say, oh, contractor doing this, architect is doing this, but where's the engineer? Engineer is like ditinggalkan. So, but it's okay, we can be unsung heroes. But at the same time, now our IEM and BEM, for your information, I'll cover what is IEM and BEM later. We are emphasizing more on publicity of engineering sector, especially for the engineers. Okay. Next, these are the challenges in engineering practices. So if you see overall, when you enter a job market, these are the qualities or job scope that you are going to deal with on your daily basis. First is the management. For your information, you might be speaking, you are studying design, you are studying theoretical formulas, so many formulas and everything. But most of your work as a civil engineer later will be on management, managing people. So listen guys, managing people is the key. So even though you are very good in theory, but if your EQ, where your communication skills, and you fail to manage people, then it will be a failure to your career. So I emphasize this, apart from your academic line, please emphasize more how to improve your interpersonal skills. So you can succeed in your management skills. So you see, in management, basically it revolves around time, financial, and personal. Actually, I don't want to go in detail, so I have some other important things to cover. Then after that, when it comes to knowledge, we have code of ethics, design code, code of practice, acts of parliament, bylaws, standards, code of conduct. So I just want to touch on the code of ethics. Code of ethics is something important where it's been emphasized for Board of Engineers Malaysia, Institute of Engineers Malaysia, to be a professional engineer, one of the main items that you need to fulfill is the test on code of ethics. That means, because you are given such a big responsibility, I will show you why it's a big responsibility. Because normally you are dealing with a lot of big infrastructure involving lives of people. Let's say you design a bridge field that will give a big impact to the society. So that's why we need a code of ethics. So it's up to you whether you want to be honest or you want to just be maybe I can say a naughty engineer who don't want to follow the codes. Then it will affect your career and affect your market as well. Okay. Then the third aspect will be the staffs, employees, peers and colleges. Human relations, I've touched that earlier. Knowledge and experience, attitude and communication. So if you see here, we have so much of things that you need to have when you enter your job market. So I can summarize lah. Betul lah my lecturer say, we are jurutera. because you have to be talented in all these fields, then only you can become a director or a good civil engineer, right? So then the last group will be the clients, contractors and suppliers. The clients, normally the people who's giving the job, who's financing the job, contractors who's implementing, then the suppliers where you do the purchases. So there are few things as you see there discovered. So it's the same thing again, it's people. You are managing people again. You have to deal with people, negotiate with people. So please emphasize this, your interpersonal skills is very important apart from your theoretical knowledge. Then finally, there's the liabilities where public safety, public occurrence and value for money. So as I said, that's a very big responsibility that you have. And now, the next slide, I'll show you roughly how engineers are put in the setup of a company. Okay. So if you see, you are always being chased by so many people. You have clients, you have top management, you have site management problems, then you have some problems. So this is where our engineer stands, is it? It's hanging there. And if he is not strong, he is not well equipped with all the necessary knowledge, experience and interpersonal skills, obviously he's going to fall down and be eaten by the client. So it's the same scenario in your job later. So make sure you are very well equipped, and please understand one thing. Engineers, if you notice, I didn't know what is the definition of civil engineers, because initially I had, you see, when an engineer is given a job, you must understand one thing. Every time this happened everywhere, so you say, oh man, banyak masalah, this one go wrong, that one rosak, or the concrete guy, he said to be di cuti, bini sersalin, the one, so then suddenly a meeting, your staff is not there to attend the meeting, a lot of problem. So if you see the problem as a problem, then it will be very difficult for you to survive in the market. So you have to understand one thing, put in your mind, accept it in your mind that engineers are employed to solve problems. If engineers are not employed to solve problems, then they can just employ anybody to do the job. So that's why with your experience, knowledge, you should be able to solve the problem. Don't worry, bila you masuk kerja first day, you'll be blank. How, where to start, how to start. And you have been studying a lot of subjects all this while. Then who knows, maybe you will be only dealing your job, you will only dealing with one subject. And maybe one topic of the subject. It happened to me. When I entered my job with consultant firm, and after 3 years working there, I was assigned as a design engineer. So my work, daily work is to design drainage. And if I recall back, at that time, I have only studied drainage design. I'm meaning the minor drainage, because we have particular subject for open channels and things like that. But we have the manning formulas and everything. I still remember we only studied for 1 week. And that's what my pure work when I was in the market. So that's why you don't need to worry, you have to know everything. Yeah, you have to know everything little bit. But you can specialize to one area. That is how the professional engineers work. When you have problem professionally, you can get some other resources to help you to go ahead with your project. Okay? Next. So, as I said, you will terror, so you have to be a superman. You have to be well equipped with everything. Okay? Then, they say, let's say, I'm a civil engineer, to save time, just assume that I'm never wrong. People might argue, why you say this? Actually, why I say this, because when I say that I'm never wrong, if you are wrong, you are in big trouble, man. Spot. There will be a big failure. Every calculation that you do is related to failure calculation. So if you take chance to be wrong, even a smallest mistake, the the consequences is very big. So that's why, put in your mind, make it right at the first time. Okay? So now I just share why I showed that slide. So these are some engineering failures that happen in this country, and I think I have one example from overseas as well. So this is engineering failure in Terengganu Stadium. You can see what happened. I think until you all aware of what happened. Okay. And this is in Highland Tower. This is caused by geotech and drainage problem. It happens after a few years of construction. Then we have JS Pro Market in PJ. KL Central while construction was going on. Already pond suspension bridge failure. Building at the plane. Then we have our University of Malaysia Terengganu. Then Masjid Batu Putih Kertih. Okay, Jalan Kuantan Sungai Wing. Then we have Bukit Lanjang stroke failure. Plus expressway stroke failure. Sorry, I'm not trying to be biased to one particular state or something that happened to be. I dapat contoh-contoh ni macam ni. Okay. So, and this is overseas. We have Shanghai in China. This, I think, the latest failure happened, I think, 1 or 2 years ago. So, if you see, even though engineers, they say, okay, kita dah buat calculation very thoroughly, but a small mistake, maybe terlepas pandang lah. Terlepas pandang, these are the consequences that they're going to face. So, that's why the integrity, the code of ethics plays a very major role in your career. So you have to, if you have a code of practice, you have standard, BS, MS, stick to it. Don't try to be, you want to change the standard law. Unless if you really think it need to be changed, there is a particular channel to change. There are cases, you do a paper, present it, prove it, then you can change. But if you are not up to that level yet, just follow what is there, because it's already proven, it will be safe. Okay, I like this particular thing. You see, Dr. Henry Petrosky, he summarized this. He said, failure is central to engineering. Every single calculation that an engineer makes is a failure calculation. But that doesn't mean you will become a failure. So, you take this. That's why, when an engineer does not failure here, say, oh, no, nothing. But what I want to emphasize here is, don't be very rigid. Don't be very. What I'm trying to say is, come out of the box. If failure happens, don't try to spend your time find faults or anything. You have to go forward. You see? So find the reason for the failures and work out how to avoid it and work out how to implement it and properly so it will stand in that. So that's why there's always difference between architect and engineer. Then this is where the code of ethics comes. So when the design goes well, it's my design. Unless it fails down, then it is yours. It happens, is it? Sometimes some senior egoist engineers, they try to make use of your junior engineers, and when the thing success, they just get the picker there, they take the film. But when things go wrong, it comes, they say, he is the one who did it. But actually, to be fair, your boss also plays a major role. So because he is the one who approved the thing. So that's why in your job scope, be very careful with whatever dealings that you're doing. Because it's one thing, we are talking about legal conduct. Second, there's involving money, there's involving written contracts. So make note of every action that you have been doing. Even though your boss asks you to do something against your will, but boss is boss, you have to look at your head. You have to do. Then when you implement, but make a note. Make a note in your diary. Make a proper diary. Make a note, tell, okay, on this, this thing happen, this thing happen. Because why, if let's say something bad happened and it goes to court, sometimes your diary carries away. I tak cakap, you can win the case, but there's something to prove. And if you can substantiate with some other evidence, it's better still. So, in any thing, just be careful. That's what I would say. In our field, engineering, you have to be very careful because you don't know what will happen. Okay, sekarang okay. After 20, 30 years, suddenly got crack, jatuh. You will be surprised to see somebody will come and knock your door. You will not contact you, will tell, hello, apa? Ah, Pluto. I tak ingat kau yang design, and then they will show. No, you sign the document. So because the liability of engineers, it carries until you die. Okay? Unless you sign for the company, they have insurance cover for the company, it's a different case. Then, as I said, there's no such thing as little mistake. So Hall of Fame, I show you what happened. I think it looks like in Malaysia, but I don't know. That's it. Is it a small mistake? I go Peking. And for your information, I have seen this in my life. Happened. I've seen toilet bowl was placed where, you know, the squatting toilet bowl was placed where I don't know how you want to sit there because it's too near to the wall. And sometimes the door is like, you know. So sometimes you need to have common sense. You need to have some common sense when you do the design. That's why we have problem. Sometimes they say engineers are like too straightforward, they go cooler and everything. So you have to come out from that scenario. Be open-minded. Whatever you do, you think common sense. Try to put yourself in that area. You design a hall. Nak buka pintu. You try to think. Okay, buka pintu, can I move freely? Will there be any obstacle? So these are the small things that you need to consider when you're making design or implementing any project. So I hope takdelah, nobody from here will do something like this. Kesian lagi. Okay. This is the interesting part to touch about. I think everybody, not aware of what is involved in Indonesia or Board of Engineers Nation. And for the international students, I do believe in your country, you should have your own Board of Engineers as well. Because as you see, in job market, when it comes to professional jobs where it involves safety and health of the people and the surrounding, then there will be a board to monitor this thing and the function of this board. So if you want to jot down, please jot down that website. It's a very important website which you will need to refer for most of your jobs and for your registration purpose as a graduate engineer, professional engineers and everything. Okay? So don't worry, I won't go through everything. I just want to say as an introduction, BEM comes at the Ministry of Works and it is, their headquarters is located in Jalan Sultan Salahuddin, same compound with the JKR headquarters, and its primary role is to facilitate the registration of engineers and regulate the professional conduct and practice of engineers, registered engineers, in order to safeguard the safety and interest of the public. If you are not registered as a graduate engineer or a professional engineer, then you are not eligible to work in this country. But there are so many people still working without registering and everything, but when they come, if they find out or they fail, if let's say they came across a problem like a failure or things like that, that's where you will get caught. If you go to court, then they say, okay, you are the one who approved the drawing. Not necessarily the one design, even the supervision engineers, site engineers who approve the work at site. If you are not registered with the board, then you are in trouble. They will say you are an illegal engineer, or rather illegal worker, now got illegal engineer at the site. So you must be very careful. So you have to be registered. I will cover how to reach the registration process later. So apart from that, all of engineers, they have scale of fees. You have any job, consultancy job, contracting job, how the scale of fees works, so you can refer the reference are given. And after that, being a member, you will be getting some publication, the engineer. It's a magazine. Then the second website that is very important is Institute of Engineers Malaysia, IEM. Okay, BEM is a government body. IEM is a NGO, or it's not non-government body, but both BEM and IEM works together. So, but most of the activities will be conducted in IEM. Okay. So if you see the function, the role of IEM, normally IEM they conduct the professional interviews, courses, and they give you a platform to represent the country or the state to present papers or anything. And currently we have more than 24,500 members, and out of 24,500 members, easily more than 60% of the members or 70% of the members are civil engineers. We have nearly 14,000 or 13,000 civil engineers compared to the mechanical and electrical, we have below 10,000. So you see the market of the engineers, especially civil engineers, very important in this country and as well as for other countries. And we have 5 official representatives on the BEM, conducts courses and professional interview. And another thing, you see, it was admitted as a member of Commonwealth Engineers Council. So that means if you're registered in an IEM as a professional engineer, that is all the Commonwealth countries will recognize you as a professional engineer. So if you have a job in that country, you don't need to go through the same process again of registering. You just go and do some formalities, then you can get a professional engineer title in that country as well. And as you see, there's a bureaucratic complication. I brought here the junior and the engineer. The engineer is a quarterly publication of IEM, and the junior is from IEM monthly publication. Maybe I'll pass around. Maybe you can have a look. Please return back. Yeah, only. And there's one particular printing material where it is a journal. So IEM also they provide journals. So if you're registered as a student members or a member, you are given a platform for you to submit journals. They have their own panel. They will go through. If everything is there, then they can publish. It is like I think every 4 months once they will publish the journal booklet. Okay. We try. So now we come to the interesting part, the career part. Okay. So basically, you see, you are a civil engineer, and as I see, there is very well diversified sectors in civil engineering. So generally, you will be ending up in government sector or a private. And in government sector, it can be a department, universities, or any other or research departments. Or in private company, you have contractors, your own business, or consultancy, and so on, or lecturer. So you see, basically, you become a junior engineer, then you become a professional engineer, then you become a consultant. The same thing, you become an executive officer, manager. And it always involves people. It's always managing people. So the more experience are you in managing people and job, the more higher you will go in your career path. So, I want to ask you something. I got to know that you guys are third year, you have one more year to go. So, just not know, anybody here have a working experience before? In civil engineering sector? Can I see any hands? Working experience? Okay, there are a few. That's good. So, I always feel who has a working experience, they always have a better understanding and better grasp of knowledge when it comes to the class in a theoretical spot. When I was in my undergraduate, it's the same thing. The lecturer was teaching us something, let's say it's a cantilever structure, or just thinking cantilever, caterpillar, what is cantilever? Because you can't imagine what's that. So it is a very hard. For me, undergraduate is the most difficult and challenging process where most of the time you can't imagine what the lecturer is trying to tell. It's all in the book. You just imagine something, say cantilever, or build, you say span pile, then it's a span pile. I know span, Amidara, what is sponge? But this one was sponge pile, or then it's a span pile. So, for those who have working experience, it's good. They can grab the knowledge very fast because they know what they are talking about, they have seen. So that's why if you have opportunity, kalau you nampak ada construction site, if you have somebody in the family or anybody in the construction, just go to site, have a visit, see how things are being done and everything. Even though it might not be very helpful at that moment, but in future it will be very helpful. So, when you are graduated, you grow up, okay, you are an engineer. So normally what you will do, the first step that you will do, you say you want to find a job. So semua akan pergi buat resume lah, ini lah. But please bear in mind, before you do this, please register as a graduate engineer, jurisprudence as well. It is very important. Until you are not registered in BEM as a jurisprudence bazaar, you will not be recognized by this country as an engineer. And if you have in mind to do professional engineers, bear in mind the experience is counted from the day you got your jurisprudence bazaar certificate. If let's say you apply your jurisprudence bazaar 5 years after you masuk kerja, the first 5 years is burned. It won't be counted as an experience. So do this. And we have the Act. The Act say you cannot practice professional service, engineering professional service without registering with BEM. So you have to be a warga negara Malaysia. But for foreigners, if they still can apply, they have some other channels, some other requirements. Okay, I'll just touch for the Malaysian. Okay, there are two ways to register as a BEM. This is very important. Please take note of this. First, as I said, BEM website is a very important website. So you go to this website, you go to the registration of graduate member. There's two ways. One, you can do it manually, or one, you can do it online. I think everybody is very well versed with IT nowadays. It's easier to do it online. Get your password and everything, sign in, then you go, okay, the process, there will be a long form, just fill up everything. I don't think so there's complicated details or questions will be asked, just basic details where you study, what course you did, or whether the course is accredited and things like that. So these are the things that you need to attach with. Okay, there is a payment of 50 ringgit for this process. So you have you need an IC. You need a true copy of degree, certified true copy of full transcript, and certified true copy of diploma or matriculation of full transcript. And when they say certified, jangan buat silap kan. For this case, you don't go and look for your pengulu, your guru besar, your lecturers to get assigned. You must get a registered professional engineer with his seal. He will have his chop with his registration number. You have to get them signed. If let's say you have problem to find one, go to BEM, ask for their referral, they will refer you to some people who can help you to sign. Okay? Then the form should be complete. Then upon approval, a certificate of graduate engineering registration form C will be issued to you. Once the registration form is issued, then you are legally a civil engineer who can practice in Malaysia. Okay? So basically, these are the route to become a civil engineer. So I'll skip this part, SPM, SPM, so now you are all in this level degree. So there are two types of degree, you see.
I'm sorry, it's
very clear, but I'll try to explain to you. So for this one, is non-accredited program. If let's say, I think education, no problem. For your friends, if you're studying in college, it's non-accredited, then they have to sit for a separate exam by BEM, or if they are from overseas, then they have a special counsel in UK, that stands to show it can be considered. Or if you are accredited program, so you can straight away register BEM in the form earlier I showed you. Then for accredited program from overseas, so it's the same. Only thing, if your overseas degree is not accredited, there are two ways to go with it. One, you repeat back this thing, take your exam or the UK council, or you do a master's in engineering from any accredited university, and then you can register as well. Okay, then when you register as a graduate engineer, there are so many sectors that you can choose. So normally it goes tie into your degree qualification. If you are from civil, then you go for civil, mechanical, electrical, mining. All engineering sectors will be out, but in civil engineering. But all these sectors revolves in particular setups. So when I say setups, we have government and we have private sector. So I go one by one, what are the setups that there are. First is the government. So basically you'll be doing management, design, approvals, provision work. Then we have contractor. Then you can read the sub thing. Then consultancy. You have oil and gas. Education, supplier, or you do your own business, maintenance, or others like bank, insurance, management, training, continuing studies. Okay. So you see, in government particularly, we have problem with government where we have a lot of students or engineers, we just do more on a management job, less on a design, and sometimes you have site experience as well. Then contractor is basically on the site. Then consultancy, you basically will be in the office. If you takut panas, then maybe you can go for consultancy, but bear in mind, in consultancy also we do have site staff to take care of the sites. Then in oil and gas, you want big money, this is where, oil and gas. Then you have education lecturer, tutor, lecturers. We have P2 students who have graduated, now is teaching in vocational technical schools. Then we have research departments like NARE, nuclear department, where we do need civil engineers. Then you have suppliers. In supplying, supplying a product, you must be well versed in the design of the product, or how to use the product, then how to market it. So this one, also, if you are hardworking, you will see big money here as well. Then being a own is always the best, but not many people have the chance or the daring to get into the own business. Okay? But I challenge you people, if you all can be your own contractor, own consultant, after a few years, it's good. Then maintenance, we have building, contact school, and so on. And we have others. Others is where sometimes you accidentally fell in the civil engineering course and you don't have flair in civil engineering, you want to go for some other lines where they just need a general degree to take up the job. So you can go for others.
Curriculum vitae.
Applying for job. So okay, I'll go one by one. Applying for a job, when you are applying for a job, make sure you have your CV, resume, CTAC. Make sure you attach a photo, and I'll just not share. Currently, I see a lot of newcomers in the market. They don't know the importance of being formal. Sometimes, bila tak photo, dia ambil dekat lebih lama. You know, sometimes with your funny faces, with your t-shirts and things like that, please spend a little bit of money, go and take a proper formal photo if possible, wear coat or wear tie or clothes, be pleasant looking, formal, and get one photo and attach with it, because that is your first impression. Okay? So the first impression plays a very important role. So sometimes because of the photo, you might be rejected. It happened. I've seen my friend who want to take his stuff, saw the photo shop. Simple thing, so they don't know the photo rule, how I want to expect them to do a much more bigger thing in a formal or perfect manner. So be careful with the photos. Then experience. All experience counts. You can just mingle, you can just mingle, put it in. For your information, sebelum I masuk civil engineering, I work in KFC. That's how you're going to be. This story I can't forget. Because in KFC, they will ask us to wear a white shirt, slacks. Then my mom asked me, hey, you could be very smart to KFC, kenapa? Jaga cashier ke? Jaga manager ke? Apa? Masyarakat ada, pergi sana pakai apron, buka ayam, potong ayam, cuci bulu ayam. That's my job. You know? So, even though it's a very small job, doesn't carry any weight for civil engineering field, but put it in your resume, because people will know, oh, this guy or this girl have worked in a, they can end up in any situation. That to show that, okay, this particular person can end up in any situation given. Even though it's a worst case scenario, they know how to deal. And as I said, the main important factor is people relation. So if you get in any job, automatically you will be learning what people relation. So that's why they want to know, okay, what you have worked. And normally, if you put there, like when I put there, I did my training in Galatan, I work as a site engineer. Then kat atas tu, you cakap, I kerja dekat Pasari Zayan, jadi penyapu sampah. Oh, contoh lah. You think, which one will be the highlight, the person who's going through the CV? Obviously, we see that, wow, this guy is not bad. He started from so small like this, he can be in this thing. So give some comparison. Try to capture the employer. So these are some tips that we... Then cover letter. Cover letter, CV, you got to go to JobStreet website, you go to any job search website, you can get some beautiful sample CV, sample letters there, where you can follow. Then get ready with all the certificates. And another big blunder, obviously, the students is email. Ramai, they have very creative email address, you know. I have one of my friend, she put her name Strawberry Devil. Strawberry Devil. Then just imagine, you apply a job, your email address, Strawberry Devil. How you think the employer will react? Or let's say you are already in one status where you are a GM of a company. Oh, okay, this is my card. Oh, you are what, Datu? Then if it's probably level, what? Then I've seen, what? Bubble Susu, Ape, Aboy, Tambi, whatever. If you have that email, keep that email for your personal use. But for your job application purpose, I think third year students, now itself you can start, even for your scholarship application, for university application, create one formal email. If possible, use your name, use your initials, which is not sensitive or anything. It's a very neutral email. Then use that. So, for information, I created my email. I was lucky @hotmail.com in Ito back in 1997. So, and I've been using that until today because I can't get any other email providers with my name there. So if you can get your name, it's perfect. But if let's say your name is very long, you know that your name is going to cause problem for them to spell or anything, make it simple. The point is simple. Make it people easily can remember. So for example, I was asked what name I want to use for my official email for my work, I just gave my first name, SREE, Sri. So whenever I go, I just say SREE, I don't need to write down and give them. So take that approach. If your name is Amiruddin, just give Ami. Or you want to give Amiruddin, it's okay. But if, let's say normally I think Indians and Chinese or people from Middle East or Africa, they will have some beautiful names that sometimes it's very hard for us to pronounce it well. Ada lagi lah, nak ada kan? So, make it simple, make it formal. That's one thing. Then, try to learn as many new skills as possible. Today, job market is very competitive. People, if you are a civil engineer, you have a first class honors degree. Nowadays, people are asking, so what? This guy has got honors degree. He is a fourth letter, 3.99. Sorry, I cannot lie. So, try to get some extra knowledge. Language, for your information, English is most spoken language in this world. But for your information, Mandarin language is catching up, and I even heard Mandarin language already surpass English. We have more Mandarin language speaking people in this world compared to English. And soon, maybe, who knows, one day, Mandarin will be business language. Who knows? Okay. And if for your advantage, if you are going to, I'm telling you, not only Mandarin language, even other languages, sometimes you see job application advertisement, preferably but this language skills, preferably that language skill. So important for you to learn language. And another thing is English language proficiency. Please, 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 civil engineers, your English is quite up, then it is very hard for you. Let's watch one video. So clear. I hope we got a message. You see, a small thing, Namati, pasal you know another language, it was safe. Same thing in the market. If you know another language, please go and learn. If you know other skills, if you are an engineer, but if let's say you know other skills, accounting is good. So try to learn extra things before you get into the job market. Okay, then you have job search, go fast. When it comes to job search, I say government job and private sector, right? So you have government job, so these are the websites that will be helpful, www.spa.gov.my. So all federal posts in Malaysia, federal government posts in Malaysia, in government, you have to apply to SPA. You know, also JKR, there's no such thing, you apply to JKR. You have to go through this. You want to apply for DPS, you have to go to SPA. Then you can even go for Majlis Daerah, Perbadanan, Bandaraya or universities. They have their own jobs. Then we have Perbadanan, like Perbadanan Putrajaya. Then some states you have SPA memory. SPA stands for Suruhanjaya Kalimantan Awang. Okay, this is where the job bank is. They take in people for a job. Then advertisement in daily newspapers. Okay? Whereas for private sector and government leading companies, you just go for advertisement, newspapers and job search sites, referral, friends and relatives. Sometimes you have friends relatives in the sector, they might have somebody who needs a civil engineer, you can go to them. Or you can even go to BEM and IEM sites, websites, sometimes they do have advertisement, especially for consultancy firms, they do advertise there. Social media, we have a lot of social media. Sometimes some friends, they just put there, hey, my company needs engineer. So you just get from there. And another new strategy that I'll show is business news. Okay, berapa orang kat sini, when you open your newspaper, you know the business section? There was a small team business section. How many of you take trouble to go through the business section? I can bet maybe none, or maybe a few of you who have interest, they will go through. But if you know something, that is a first-hand information for you to know which company got a job. You know, normally you see the news there, they end up, for instance, Randhill just secured 2 billion jobs in India. This Sakura Crest just secured a tender in Sudan, or they got a North-South Highway project. So this is when this news is coming out, when the tender was signed or offered. So the next thing is, within 1 or 2 weeks, obviously these companies are going to look for engineers and workers. So why you want to wait until they call for the advertisement or thing? When you see this thing, go to their website, try to get their address right into them directly. Save time. Before they now throw out an advertisement, you see if somebody has already put in the application, refer to the, we put a reference in the letter. I'm referring to the article in Star Paper on Scan. You have just secured a job listing, and with my qualification, I would like to put in my application for this particular post or any equivalent post under the capacity of my qualification. When I get, if I'm an employer, I get a thing, first impression I get, wow, this guy is very proactive. He's following the news. He's following it. Obviously, you win the first impression without seeing your face as well. So try to use this tool as well. Okay? Next, I say write in to all the companies, walk in even when they don't have an opening, just write in as much as possible. And if let's say for people who are the good, they might take you and put in a reserve category. If somebody leaves, they can straight away call you in. Then if let's say you don't get job, don't waste your time. No. Do any job to gain experience before you arrive at a green job. Why? You can get money. Second, you can get experience. As I said, people management experience is very important in this field. So any job, doesn't matter, it's not engineering, so you still are going to manage people, so it's very important to get experience. And save money, and that is the key to be your own boss. Okay? Okay, I will just explain further on global jobs. In SPA, you see there are some list of posts that you can apply. If you go to their website, or this website, you will see all the skim jawatan in government, inclusive of engineering, admin staff, everything. Kalau you nak tahu what further information about the job, click here. You will get this. Okay, this is for J41. Okay, this is your. They will have all the things. What is the requirement and what is the restricted to us? Okay, this is the gaji minimum, gaji maximum. For information, this is basic salary. All in for current fresh graduates or Jurutera J41, we will be getting about 2,900 to 3,000 ringgit. And currently, government sectors are giving the highest in the market for entry level. But sooner or later, private sector will overtake you. But now, after the revision, I think better lah. Sekarang dia punya, because ya kadar kenaikan tahunan is now 225, previously it was just 90 ringgit. And for those who already have working experience, I mean working experience in after degree, if let's say you kerja kat consultant firm, like what I did last time, kerja in consultant firm, after that I went to government sector, if let's say you have worked for 4 years, you can apply for that experience as well in the government. So what it will do, they will assess all the information, then they will give you 4 years of Kenaikan Gaji. So you can do that, you can match back to the salary that you got in your private sector. Then sometimes they do have other, even pegawai perkhidmatan, they need a civil engineer. You can go through, and you can see sometimes there are jobs like Ijazah Sarjana Menteri Sains Pengujian, general. If there's general qualification for any job, you can apply also. But if you see the general starting with 2001, civil 2003, science perikanan 2002, still civil engineers are getting higher. Okay. So as you know, the main government departments employing civil engineers are JPR and JPS. JPR they have about 10,000 engineers. JPS they have 80,000 engineers. And why JPR have 10,000 engineers? Because other kementerian, other departments are getting the engineer supply from JPR. JPR will pinjamkan the engineers to other centers. So, you want to apply to JPR, JPS, don't go to their website and apply. You must apply to SPA. you might be called for interview for JKR, but ended up
interview. Yeah,
that's what happened to me. I was asked all JKR questions, tanya PJPS, tak pernah dengar pun. So that's one thing in government you can choose.
Yeah,
you can choose what interview you want to do. You'll get a civil engineer job, but if you speak hunting, gathering, what else you want to do? Then you want to see what, where you want to go in future. So these are the normal questions we ask in your interview. So be prepared for all these things. And another thing that we learn, don't lie. Because civil engineering community is very small. Everybody interconnected. So those, even if you is hot, or you are the, you have enemies, better be friends. Because you won't know, maybe one day your enemy will be your boss, or maybe he will be the approving officer, and then you will be in trouble. So don't lie, and if you lie in the interview, sometimes they know you are lying. Be honest about yourself. If you really don't know, in fact, in the interview, if they really don't know, just say, I don't know. I did that in my interview for a government job. They asked me how you want to determine shear stress. For information, my structure is not so good. And I left structure so long. Suddenly, they asked the question, I was like, I'm going to be a bintang. I went for a JKR interview. So I said, I'm sorry, I can't answer this question. I have left. But today, I'm in GPS. They do take you, if you are honest. Unless all PC is cut, tak tahu, then you balik lah. Then, respect the job, respect the employer. So, don't think about yourself, don't be selfish. You might be comfortable with your appearance, but maybe the person is not comfortable with your appearance. If you give respect to the job that you are applying, the job will come to you. If you don't have respect, you don't take it seriously, and normally, you might get out of luck. Punctuality is very important. First impression, as I said, is very, very important. Dress properly, formal, even for site engineer's job. Jangan pakai safety boot begitu. Wear properly, if possible, wear tie. Tie is a must, I would say, for interviews, for men. If you have coat, wear coat. You know why you have to wear coat? Especially for big jobs or any jobs, first thing they'll say, wow, this guy is dahsyat. That's one thing. First impression itself. Then they know he knows how to be formal in what place. That's very important. You must know how to dress at which occasion. And second, when you wear coat, automatically you will feel like, oh, people are looking at you sometimes. Your self-esteem will go high. Maybe that's why I'm wearing clothes really good. Because obviously you may feel up and down. That's one thing. Then groom yourself, comb your hair nicely, things like that. Cut your hair. Long hair. Sorry guys, you have long hair, you can you cut, at least tie it nicely and go. Because nowadays we have a lot of professional long hair. They are cleaner. If government sector is a bit hard, sorry. And another true story happened. Just a few months ago, one of my colleagues, he went to conduct interview for government staff. Then he saw CV Chun, Chong Mo Best. The result is upper, everything is good. He came with tie, shirt, pants, sport shoe. My friend really got pissed off. You see, first thing he came and said, he said, how I want to consider you as a candidate when you don't even know how to dress. You think it's suitable how you're coming in. It might be comfortable, it might be suitable, it might be funky for you. But it is not funky for the employer. Because when you are coming for such an important event like that, how long it will take for you to attend a very important meeting in the same manner? That's the thing. Sometimes your certificates are very beautiful, but if you fail on this thing, sometimes it will affect your career. You might be rejected straight away. Then, English language requirement. English language, as I said, is very important. I know nowadays a lot of students, we have problem with English language. For your information, I share with you my own story. I come from a family background where we don't speak English in the house. We are not English speaking people. And we faham, speak script, things like that, but we don't converse daily, like most of us in this hall also, I guess. Okay? Because normally, a lot of Indian families, they use converse in English and their English is very good. But I'm a different case. I came from Moa, in kampung surrounding, my family members, they like to speak in Malay between each other. Until today, I talk to my uncle in Malay. It's been like a tradition. But when I entered university, I had problem with English. Then I went to university. That was the biggest headache I felt. Thank God, Masai Baja Sini, I had a bunch of friends who are all English speaking. I picked up English degree. Then, first day in the job, I was in Kerti. Excited. Dan masuk, umur baru 22, tak sampai 22 pun. Masuk, hebat lah, kira dah dapat kerja tu dah kira hebat kan. Dulu, saya was civil engineer. I thought what my mom would be thinking of me. Pergi, then my immediate boss came, he said, okay, Sri, there are about 10-15 letters here. I've already given the reason for rejection of contractor's claim. Contractor made a claim, I have to reject. He had given the reason, he asked me to draft a letter. The letter, I tell you, it's only 3 or 4 lines. One letter, first letter in my life, took me one whole day to draft. I was like, nangis. I said, oh my God, so simple, I don't know what to do. Then, what I did, I was no one, ada orang kat situ, nak tolong. Ada admin staff, I pergi tanya, Kak, boleh tolong apa? Media Terengganu lho kan? I said, oh, that's it. All went through. So, think, when I was in stress, what I did, when I opened the old files. Buka old files, see how they drafted the letter. Then I found about 3 set of letters been repeating the cara ditulis, been repeating the pattern. So what I did, I took the letter, cip lah. So, that's the same thing, you don't know, jangan malu nak tanya, copycat. In exam, you don't copy, but in actual fact, we do that. But don't copy other people's work. I mean, when you don't know, ask around, copy, things like that. When I can do, and after that, by experience, you deal, you attend meeting, you have to focus in English. Your contract documents are all in English. Contract documents, even a very good English background people also will have problem to go to contract documents with their legal thing. Apa lagi kalau you are not well versed with English. If you have money, extra money, spend that money, go and take English course. At least, tahulah membaca, tahulah nak jawab. Then after that, I got masuk government sector. My private sector experience helped me to improve my English. Government sector, I got all Malay. Yes, Malay. For your information, your interview in SPA will be conducted in English. Nowadays, all interviews are conducted in English. I have friends currently looking for civil engineer with 1 or 2 years experience. If anybody who has friend, ask, come and see me. Okay? He's looking for friends in the lab. 3 months he's looking for staff. Janata, staff, engineer came in with 2 years experience, ask question in English. She was just staring.
Macam
mana kita nak proceed? So, that's why it's very important to get the English language. Okay? And the second thing, social media warning. Guys, this is very important. You all have Facebook, Twitter and everything. Now you want to enter job market. It's a professional market. People are watching. The moment you put in an application to job, don't be surprised. People will be finding you in Facebook and see who are you, how you will be living. So, kalau you ada gambar-gambar yang menarik dalam tu, remove it. For time, from this point on, especially when you are applying for jobs, remove it. It's happening. People are going through Facebook's, who are you? The moment you put there your profile is private, you know. That means you are hiding something big. Something not good. That's what they will think. Maybe you are hiding because you don't want to show some personal family photos or something. Maybe you are not jadi famous girl. But this is what people will think. They say you are hiding some not good to things in me. Okay, now I have 3 videos that will run straight in play. English language requirement, social media, I have 2 videos. But first of all, there was one video on the social media, the second video, I apologize first, because I had to know whether I want to show this video. No, you and I discussed with the Urus the other day. There was one or two pictures, it's a bit disturbing. There was a picture of a man. If you can tolerate WWE fighters with their spender and spender kat luar tu, I think they tolerate this. If it disturbs you, I would like to apologize first. Okay. Sekarang ni, maybe few of you in this hall might be working in overseas, applying for overseas job. For information, in my batch in Ito, we have 2 of them in UK now working there full time. They have already migrated. So, in that particular world, they are already going to Facebook asking you to post something, ask your friends to comment. Just imagine your friend commenting. If let's say they know it's a serious business, it's okay. Sometimes you just imagine some informal, then sometimes they give very canggih canggih words, which they not so good. So be careful on the Facebook. So kalau dah nak habis belajar ni, go and clear your Facebook. If you have something, even don't put it private or thing. The moment you put private, then people will know you're hiding something bad or you're hiding something. That's the impression it's doing. So be careful on the social media. Okay. I think I'm running out of time. I will pass on the IEM official interview. I'll touch on the important things. Later, I'll open for Q&A. Then you can answer me on the IEM official interview. Okay. So, to be a professional engineer, what do you mean with professional engineer? Professional engineer is where you will be given a status quo called professional engineer with the title IR. IR stands for engineer in a French word. Okay, when you have this, you are like so-called legally licensed to practice engineering. That means you are legally able to sign designs, design reports and design drawings. Kalau engineer biasa, you are not entitled because your registration number will be there, and that registration number will be used if there's any legal implication. So you are taking a very big responsibility before you sign. You won't believe my ex-boss, he got phobia of sign. He went through very bad experience. Bila nak sign je, tangan dia pergi ni. Because kalau tersalah, maybe you'll be dragged up to court, you can even go into jail. That's where the code of ethics comes in. So, after you become a graduate engineer, you will have a minimum standard of practical training, professional interview, you become IEM corporate member, and professional engineer of EM. Okay. First, you must have attained the age of 24, completed engineering degree program accredited by IEM, registered with BEM as a graduate engineer. Graduate membership with IEM is not compulsory at the moment. Because you nak jadi IEM graduate member, you can get the benefit of the routine or get access to the activities, but it's not compulsory. But BEM is compulsory. Why? Here, you must have completed at least 3 years of experience in planning, design, execution, or management of such works as comprised within the profession of engineer. Cakap minimum 3 tahun. You know where 3 tahun starts? That date when you get the when you get the graduate membership of BEM. If let's say you masuk, you habis graduate this next year 2014, you lupa nak register. After 4 years you are registering. Let's say 2018 you baru nak register. Then tapi dah kerja dekat 5 tahun. For your information, that 5 tahun is not counted for your PE application. It must be from the day of your certificate, BEM, Jurutera Siswasa or Graduate Engineer. If the date is 2 days, then the experience starts from today. So, it's 3 years. Then, this is the same thing.
Dapat,
okay, then the experience should be acquired in design site besides application of engineering science and knowledge. So there are two ways to get your professional engineer to be done. One, if you are working under a direct supervision of a professional engineer, then you move it. But if let's say normally kalau we masuk consultant firm, you have no problem. Even government sector sometimes you have no problem because you will have somebody in your organization with PE. So even though they are not directly supervising you, you can still ask them to be your supervisor. But the problem starts when you don't have a professional engineer, especially for contractors, suppliers. We are lacking of professional engineers. Normally, there's no requirement for a professional engineer to be there. It's bukan no requirement. There's no specific requirement for a professional engineer to be the site. They say as long as you have a so-called visually experienced student. But if you have a professional engineer IR, it will be extra advantage, maybe your salary will be higher lah. So in this case, you have to appoint a mentor. You have to use a logbook system. Here you just prepare an experience report. Here you have to have a logbook, you pergi ke IEM, get a logbook. Then, if you don't have a mentor, if let's say you have anybody that you know from PE, you assign them as a mentor. And that particular person must be a civil engineer PE. You cannot go and get a mechanical engineer PE to access your work. So, okay, civil engineer, if let's say you may not have access, you don't know anybody with PE, then what you do, you go and get, you go and meet IEM and ask for their advice, they will refer you to a mentor. They will assign you a mentor. Then what you have to do, you get the logbook, you jot down what you have been doing every day for jobs and everything. Basically your experience to prove that you have done design, you have done cycles and everything. So mentor really same organization or any organization must be PE in any consulting firm or even in contractors again. Okay. So this is the logbook system. Okay, I think I missed something. Okay. Or apply to IEM for mentor. And to be endorsed by mentor at quarterly intervals. So every 3 months you have to see the mentor, update him, I've done this, get him signed. Then once a year to be endorsed by IEM. For those who had returned from overseas, then if let's say you have an overseas experience, you want to put in, then you must have a professional engineer in the overseas to approve your equivalent respective country and a local professional engineer as well. There's an extra requirement there. Then it is BM's requirement that the candidate should have been at least 1 year working experience locally. Then, for those who are graduated after January 2005, you are needed to attend some professional development program trainings. So there are, this was conducted by BEM and IEM. So you have to attend these courses, Code of Ethics, Engineering Management, Safety and Health, topics related to branch of engineering. So actually, if you go to BEM website, there's a form here that you guideline you can download, you can go through all this thing. So if let's say, okay, this one, they say January 2005, right? But it always changes. They have some requirement of years that you have to meet. Maybe next year it will become 2006. 2007. So, you check the website regularly to see whether you are still another or maybe within the 3 years, the first 3 years you can attend these courses. It's about 250 ringgit, 3 or 4 days courses. Then if you are lucky, maybe your company or department can sponsor you, then it's better still. You not necessarily have to be working to attend these courses. If you are not working, you have money, just attend this course thoroughly. You will learn a lot of things, and thirdly, you have a chance to meet some people in the industry, maybe you can get a job opportunity from there. Okay. Then on top of that, you must have 30 units of professional development programs. Like today, you attended this course, 3 hours course, so you have 3 points. So you need to accumulate, you attend some functions in IEM, gather, they call it CPD points. So you accumulate the points, you must have 30 points in order for you to sit for the exam. Okay, for civil engineering candidate. Civil engineering candidate, they can choose which field they want to go for the PE. You can go for civil engineers, then you can go for lecturers, you can go for researchers, and so on and so forth. Okay, for civil engineering candidate, these are the minimum requirement they are asking. At least 12 months of site experience, 12 months of design experience, 12 months of any related experience in the civil engineering sector. People have problems with design experience, especially those in the government sectors and contractors. They always have problems with design experience. People fail because of the design experience, lack of design experience. When I say 12 years, 12 months, it's not continuous 12 months. It can be accumulated. If let's say you're working in a government sector where you're doing project management, you're doing design, you're doing it, you just accumulate, you know, many months. Okay, I've done this. So after 3 years, you just accumulate, you dapat 12 bulan. Not necessarily straight 12 months you have to work in site or you have to work in design. As long as you can boleh accumulate the many months, then it's good enough. Okay? So that's why they will ask you to put a summary, how many months you have worked, which job and everything. If you are undergrad, senang lah. For research candidate, then you will be engaged in research work at the time of application, have been engaged in responsible position on engineering research for a period of at least 2 years, have had in addition to two above either A, not less than 4 years experience, which may include 1 year approved postgraduate study, up to 3 years on research for higher degree, research plus being a teacher or lecturer. Or, if let's say you don't have all this section A, go back to the normal civil engineer's practice. If you have previous site experience, design experience, planning experience, that's good enough. So, don't think, if you're not working in a site, not working in a design office, you cannot be a professional here. Being a researcher, also you can be a professional. That's the way. Only thing, a lot of people, they don't know, so they don't have the information. You pergi kat website dia, get the information, call them, talk to them, they will guide you how to get things done. Because they also want more professional engineers other than civil line. Because we want to get more people get things done. For lecturers, whoever lecturer, especially for lecturers, is interesting. You also have a chance to become an IR. Then there's some people might say, I've had such experience already. So obviously, because you're lecturing, you might not have a chance to be accepted for design. So they have their ways. Engage in teaching and approve engineering or advanced diploma at the time of application. Have been engaged in teaching the final 2 years of the engineering degree course for a period of at least 1 year. That means the last 2 years of your course will be where all the top engineering subjects will be taught. So you must be engaged in that at least for 1 year. And 1 year equivalent practical experience in teaching or any experience will do related to civil engineering. Plus, not less than 3 years experience, which may include full-time postgraduate study or on research of the award of a higher degree or research done with holding the position of teacher in the approved degree course. So, these are the things. So, there was another, after this I'll tell you. For other disciplines like electrical, mechanical, your requirements is different. You just need 6 months of design experience and 6 months of site experience. And they do have some other requirements which I left here. If you're interested, just go to the website and get download the files, then you can see the IEM and PEM website. That's where you can get all this information. And for those who are planning to continue their studies, so I was about to know from the group here, there are some because they want to continue the studies, but they are scared they cannot be a professional engineer, things like that. First thing first, register yourself as a graduate engineer in EEM. Okay, if the skills 3 years, if you are going to do PhD or masters, and obviously you cannot go for civil engineering BE, because you don't have design experience, you don't have site experience. But obviously you can go for research candidate or lecturing candidate, but still 3 years won't be sufficient. Because you need to be engaged full time, you know, saying. But it will help you to run point. Maybe after you start to work, you might need to work for another 1 or 2 years, then you can go for a thing, then you can use the experience you gain in your masters and PhD level to combine and to submit the report. Actually, it all depends. You see the process, professional degree process. They ask you to provide a report on training and experience, a logbook if applicable, and drawings and other documents. Actually, you will be given, you will be appointed with two interviewers. One will be the main interviewer, second will be the second interviewer, chosen by the main interviewer. And these are the two people that you are going to interview. And don't worry, in this interview, because they are professionally handled, they have all the posts and everything, so it won't be referred to another board to get the Google to see the report. These are the two guys that will be going to the report. If you can convince them that you are capable, you have all the employment, it's okay. If you can convince them that my studies experience and my working experience is good enough for me to get my PE, then it's okay. So it all depends on you. But sometimes, again, you're dealing with people. Sometimes, sorry lah, kalau dapat orang memang pada tak betul, then susah sikit lah. But, jangan takut. Normally, if you think the interviewer is crossing the border, you can lodge a complaint to the IEM. Okay, for your information, you have EEM and IEM. So you're thinking, who's conducting this interview and thing? IEM don't award you PE or IR. They only award you, elevate you to corporate member status. Okay? How to become a corporate member? Professional interview is conducted by IEM. Then BEM, BEM is the one who gives you the status of PE and IR. So that means government is the one who endorsing your achievement. Nak dapat that particular certificate, what you have to do? You have to submit. You have to submit the corporate membership certificate from IEM to BEM. So, bila you submit, okay, I'm already a corporate member in IEM. Automatically, we will accept you as a BE. Understand? Eh? So, but BEM do conduct their own PE assessment. But this is very specialized. If those who have missed code, tak lupa PE and everything, but you are registered with BEM, and if you have already registered more than 15 years, you go to BEM, tell them, I have already registered more than 15 years, so I want to apply for my PE. Okay, you will get some express PE application process. You no need to go through a lot of design, you know, the drawings or documents. Dia tak susah macam ni lah. Dia akan senang. Dia just submit a report. Because I belum di Timurus, I don't have experience. I don't know much about the report they want. But I've seen my bosses did that. And it is much, much more easier than this. So kalau siapa yang malas want to do, then you can go 15 years lah. Then you can do that for 15 years. At the time, maybe malu lah. You see your staff ada PE, you ada PE. Oh, so, go meeting. This is
post
day. So, so basically, you have to submit two reports. One is your training report. Four, five pages only. You have to submit. You just summarize your training report. They don't want to know. Oh, I've done this. I've done this. They want to know. Okay, you have done this. Take few experiences in your working life who highlight it, tell them what are the problems that you have encountered and how you have solved the problem using your sound engineering judgment and knowledge. That is what they're looking for. They don't want to see, oh, I have designed Galaxy C, I have designed this, this is what everybody is doing in the design. But I want to know how I want to assess you, whether you really are fit to be a professional engineer. That means your conduct as an engineer is very important. That's how they assess. You put there, okay, so you now have a problem, I got the, suddenly my, let's say I designed a beam, the beam got cracked, or the, what, the crushing test failed. How you encountered the problem? I did a rebound hammer test, I did this, I did that, 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 then it passed. You know, the counter process that you did to rectify the problem, that's what they want to see, how you tackle the problem. Even staff problem, if you have staff problem that like you suddenly manage resources, or suddenly I have 10 projects, I have only 5 staffs, how am I going to do to settle this? You want to do a planning, do a staffing planning, that experience also can be included. But one thing I tell you from my own experience, engineering problem is not a problem. There's a solution. Open book, tanya orang boleh. Handling people problem is the biggest thing. If you don't believe, start to work, you will know. That's why I always say to people, if you put me a challenge for me to design a pond in a desert, like Sahara Desert, I think 90% I can do. I can find the technology and do. But if you ask me to change a person, I think that one 90% maybe I cannot do. Unless you really work hard to change. So, you have to see, mixing with people is very, very important and tackling them is very important. So that experience is also important. So as you see, all the reports you have to submit two copies. And after the experience report, you have to submit the design report. Just take one design. Okay, this is where people make mistake. Everybody thinks, jadi professional engineer, I have to know everything. You know, all the tabang, water resource structure, blah, blah, blah. No, no, no. You just specialize in one area. You are not able to remember everything. But you should know basic things of the thing. Okay, like from my process, what I did, I just submitted a surface drainage design. And the interviewer should only ask you questions related to design. How you create the design, what assumption you have done, so they will probe you with a lot of questions just to see whether if you really understand what you have done, are you really capable of taking design. They are not interested in your design per se, what you are designing. They are interested in procedure, how you design, how you tackle problem, how you set up things, how you, you know, when I give you any type of design, you must know the procedures. That's what they want to assess. They are not going to assess you, hey, your design is Allah, how you can do this, blah, blah, blah. If there's a mistake, they will highlight you, they will give you a chance for you to rectify and come back to you. But still, if you fail, wait for maybe 8 months or 1 year, then you can reapply again. Okay? Then for the drawings and other documents, it's additional requirement for your document, your design. So you just put it. And another thing, you have to know the bit of quantities, how to do the taking off, calculate quantity, everything will be there. It is well guided in the website. You can see what they really want. If you have a problem, just go to IEM, ask them how to do it, they will tell you about it. Or you meet people like who have already done, they will be free even to give my report to you guys. I can even give my report. Even though my report is part of my own, still can use as a guide. Things like that. Just ask. What do you have to do? Just ask. I will look at you. Then for researchers, they have to submit the published papers or evidence of research carried out by him or her. A thesis already accepted for higher degree may not be acceptable. Okay? So your degree, PhD, master's, final project or thesis, it might not be accepted because sometimes you want to see what is the content, what is the engineering thing. If it's too academic, sometimes they won't take it. If it is like well contained, then they will consider. So the oral interview, they will ask you basic engineering training and project probability calculation, Christian relations, about 30-45 minutes. Then you have this is what you're looking at. Okay. One thing from my experience, I'll tell you, if the report is genuinely done by you, don't worry, you can answer. Problem starts when you cheat in the report. You take somebody else's report, put in and go, tanya soalan tempat yang kita tahu memang kurang. What happened to my report? I did drainage part. There was one particular paragraph about structural concrete. What I did, I copied from my friend's report and put in. It's for the hardening of the concrete. Then I complete tak berapa ni. So, aku masuk lah dalam tau. I was surprised, my first question was from that paragraph. He said, are you sure? Is this? I was like, what is talking? I was like, oh my god. But somehow I managed to answer because I can recall what I've written. So, this is where when you make copy from somewhere else, make sure you know what you're copying and you know what you're writing in. If you are not sure, then better don't put. If you ask this thing, you're stuck, you cannot answer, you might be fine. So, then the second part is the essay. Section A will be on the training. You know, you submit two reports, right? One is the training and another one is a design report. So your question will be based on the training and the design report. So like I'm from Department of Irrigation and Drainage, because you have two interviewers, so they will give you two questions to choose from. So I got a question, please explain about master drainage, the importance of master drainage plan. And there's another question, something to do with drainage. So dia takkan lari. If let's say they start to you submit something hydraulic, then they ask you structural question which nothing to do with you. Actually, the interview is on fault. You can report. You say it's not fair. It's asking beyond your thing because they are not testing your knowledge on that particular field. How to do? They're testing you how the procedure of doing the design. Do you know how to do that? If you know, then if you, I put you in the road drainage or even structural design, you should know the method. That's what they want to know. Okay. Then section B, you have code of ethics. Code of ethics is now. Before the exam itself, when you register, they already give you 16 questions. 16 questions. On the day of essay, out of the 16 questions, 2 questions will come out. So you just answer. So you prepare the answer, lah. Pergi cari lah all the 16 questions. But ask around, there are people who has the answer scheme prepared, so maybe it will help. Macam buat, there was a book circulating with a guide for each question. And for your information, my interviewer, after the interviewer told me, section A, they can fail you. Section B, they cannot fail you. Because it's your opinion. Unless you baru mula belajar lah, biar sahaja you write pun tak boleh nak faham langsung. You wrote if your language grammar is totally out, people cannot understand what you have written, then they will fail you. But normally you cannot fail because it's your opinion. And normally without studying also you can answer because it's normally deals with our prepared. If you are grammar staff, confirm masuk akan kau. One of the integrity questions like that, it will come out. So, as I said, improve your English, read a lot, you will get. Okay, another thing I missed out, you might say, alamak, macam mana your report English saya tak baik, and then, when you're applying for your professional interview, there is a language, there's a column there, you can choose what language you want to have in the interview with them. If you are not good in English, put Malay. If you are not good in Malay, put English. But once you put Malay, your interview, your report, everything must be in Malay. You tak boleh ada report in English, interview in Malay. Normally problem starts where, you know? Interview Malay, report nak buat Malay, tapi report you see in the working experience all in English. Normally the reports are in English. Tadi dalam bahasa Melayu, even for approval, you submit to say in English, then you have to translate. Then you want to write essay, if your English is not good, then man, you just go for Malay. I have a lot of friends who did in Malay and they have passed. So, it's not a problem. You must see boleh dapat tinggi, even if you don't have your English. Okay, I think it takes nearly 1 year for the whole process to finish. It will cost about 1,000 ringgit. Progressively, first you pay 200, then after 300. Every few months, you reserve money. Some company, they sponsor you. Some company, they won't sponsor you. Okay, this one I have to cover. Then, once you get the PE, every year you have to maintain 50 hours CPD hours. If tak cukup, your registration boleh digantung. If you don't renew, you have to renew your membership yearly basis with payment for 100 plus 200 ringgit in EM and IEM. You fail, I think the first time you fail, you can be suspend. If it's prolonged, you might be totally out of the board. And if you want to come in back, you have to go through the professional interview once again. So it's very important every year you just pay, allocate the money, pay the fees. Some companies, they will subsidize the fees. Government department normally they will subsidize the BEM fees, but they won't subsidize the IEM fees. Before I finish, I just want to share with you, if you have your dreams, you see on your way, relatives, friends, there are so many factors that will be holding you. Why? Because they love you. They don't want you to be in trouble. But don't be demotivated. Be strong. Prove to them that you can achieve what you want to do, your goal. Okay? Then, last thing I want to talk about is marketing. But don't worry. I'm just sharing with you what I think is good. I'm not doing any marketing. I have nothing to do with the CDRD or anything. First, I asked one of the lecturers here, are we teaching the students about construction business management? Construction business management is one course where you will learn about reading. Have you seen in the Swiss paper all the balance sheet, all their accounting? So it's very important in construction business, because in construction business you will be dealing with money. You need to know how to handle money, how to put in tanker, how to put in the muscle. I belajar, the subject was not there, but now I know. But I think even my lecturer in masters, he told me this is a very good subject that need to be included in undergraduate program, maybe as an elective. But if possible, try to learn about financial management. It's very important. If you have the drops of financial improvement, you can go further in your field. Because after 10 years, your technical input will be less, you will be more on managerial level. That's where the financial matters comes in. Then, secondly, bring personal money. Because, you see, you are fresh graduates, you go out, you will your pay about 2,000, 3,000 ringgit. If it's in Kuala Lumpur, 2,000 ringgit is not now, it is very difficult period. So, from my experience, I've read some books. I would really encourage you guys to read this particular book. Because this is Malaysia scenario, well explained. And there are some other books also, or you can go to their website, this website, to get drafts. Okay, how to manage your money, how to save, how to manage credit cards. Because normally you guys will be the easiest target for the banks to fall for credit card trap and so on. And first thing first, set in your mind you need to save money. Once you tak boleh nak save money in the first step itself, and it will be difficult for you to save the money even after that because your commitments will be increasing, ever increasing. Okay? And some autobiographies that I would like to highlight, Tan Sri Lim Gotong, my story, is very good for civil engineers because he will talk about his construction experience. Tan Sri Shi, I'm not very, I hope I spell his name right. That one shows very good as an entrepreneurship. And another extraordinary autobiography that I've ever read is Sir Richard Branson. If you don't know who Sir Richard Branson, he's the one who was wearing Air Asia skirt a few weeks ago in the newspaper. Okay, he's a self-made millionaire, school dropout. His group name is losing my virginity because his company name is Virgin Group. You read extraordinary, you will learn something from that. I think that's about it. As I said, we have this comment. Thank you very much, and very sorry to drag you so long. And I'm open for Q&A. If you have any questions, please be free to ask me. Yes.